A former gang member named Dominic Morrow, who was shot twice and considered medically dead for over 3 minutes in 2009, tells his powerful story of having experienced hell while he was unconscious.
I was medically dead for 3 minutes and 47 seconds.
What he saw is something people need to hear.
I joined a gang at a very young age, between the age of 12 and 13. I had a rough life. You know, Chicago was a hard place to grow up. Unfortunately, I took that route. Years have passed, and I pretty much mastered the craft, so to speak, of the streets. Give my life to, I consider them like a family to me. And come to find out, they stabbed me in the back and set me up to get me killed. Hey, wait a minute, something is not right, and I had a weird feeling in my gut about this guy. All of a sudden, I looked up, and the guy looked at me with a smirk, and he just kind of like evil grin, like, I got you. It was just like it was so evil, but I just remember everything moving in slow motion, and I fell back. This kind of darkness is not a darkness that's here on Earth. This darkness is alive. So as I'm falling, I knew this was hell, and then I heard the screams of the people.
While many alleged near-death experiences are false and deceptions, and we know that because they present false and unbiblical salvation messages, we believe that his experience was a true one that God allowed him to have.
And the first thing I noticed were these demons, things, they're the most grotesque, smelliest, Hollywood can't even get close to how these things look.
Dominic says that as he descended into hell, he fell into what was an immense abyss.
But the weirdest part was, when I fell backwards, I started instantly falling forward. I was falling down face forward as I fell backwards. That was the weirdest part. That's the spiritual aspect of it. But as I'm falling, I don't even know how to measure it. You know, they say the speed of light is 186,000 miles per second. It was faster than that.
As he fell, he felt himself being stripped of everything that is good. Everything that people take for granted, such as hope, love, etc., since it all comes from God. James 1:17, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Dominic was stripped of all of it.
But the further I'm going down, just falling and falling, falling, the more and more I felt like I was getting stripped of everything. I knew I was getting stripped of the things that God gave me that I took for granted, like hope, love, fellowship, patience, everything. The further I was falling down fast, everything was getting stripped from me, and I was getting more and more afraid. But this is a different type of fear.
He talks about the stench of hell, which is so bad that he cannot fully describe it.
But as I'm falling and I'm falling, I'm feeling more and more frightening. I started hearing, the first thing I noticed was laughter around me. As I'm falling, it was like this laughter, and it was like these giggling, little but the laugh itself, they were laughing, I felt it. It was a different type of laugh. It was a demonic hatred. Like, I just knew whatever was laughing at me hated me more than, like, with anything you can even describe. But as I'm falling, I hear this laughter. The second thing that caught my attention was this horrible smell. But I smelled this smell, and the smell, I can even just talking about it right now, so I'm sorry if I pause a little bit, because this, a lot of this comes back to me and I still get a little emotional, but the smell alone is so bad. Like, I can't even describe it. There's nothing. You can have a thousand corpses and dead animals and whatever you want to put into the mush. It smells like Febreze compared to what I smell.
This corresponds to others who have had experiences of hell. St. Bede the Venerable, a Benedictine monk who lived in the 8th century, wrote about the experience of Dritheum, a man who saw hell during a near-death experience around the year 696. Dritheum eventually became a monk, but he described hell as having, quote, a stench foul beyond compare, end quote.
So as I'm falling and falling, then I notice a little light, and it was so small, it was a pinpoint of light, and I heard, and as I'm falling, it's getting bigger and bigger, and then that's when it hit me. I knew, and I thought it was a fairy tale. I'm not gonna lie, I just thought hell was a fairy tale. I thought it was a place of fantasy. I thought it was a scare tactic used by religions. I knew, I said, I'm going to hell. See, time doesn't exist over in eternity the way it exists here. So all the time that I'm falling, people say, how would you have time? Time doesn't exist the way you can't even fathom it. Eternity it has no time. So as I'm falling, I knew this was hell. And then I heard the screams of the people. The screams and the yells of while as I'm falling in this portal, may I call it the portal, was getting bigger. You can just hear, and I knew it had to be billions, hundreds of millions of billions of people down there. I mean, screaming, and then their screams are gut-wrenching. The same way I heard those demonic laughs, I can feel it in my gut and feel it in my soul. Those screams were worst because it was suffering. It was blasphemous things being yelled. It was just horrible, you know, people begging for one more chance. I mean, the thing is, when you're in the spirit, you can hear 1,000 noises at one time, but you can decipher and know each one, whether they're playing simultaneously or not. You can distinctively know and hear everything.
He describes the heat of hell.
But as I fall and I see this portal, it looked like old cave, like I'm entering an old cave system. Okay, and then that's when I felt the heat. See, now I'm looking back on it. It probably already was hot when I got closer to it, but I was so shocked and so terrified by everything else, I didn't pay attention to the heat until I actually got into the first portion of the portal. And then that's when the heat hit me on top of everything. It was just a bombardment of everything. And, you know, here on Earth, in our physical bodies, we feel things separately, meaning, like, you know, our nervous system. So if you get poked in your back, you get punched or something like that, you can feel it just kind of in that spot. But no, there you feel it all simultaneously at one time. Pain, everything, it's your whole body. But when I felt this heat, it's a different fabric. It's a different fabric of heat. It's not like how you burn your finger here. It's a spiritual component to it because it's beyond. I mean, just say if I wanted to put it on a temperature scale, I would say 12,000 degrees and up.
St. Alphonsus stated, quote, "There are numerous texts in sacred scripture which demonstrate that the fire of hell is a true material and corporal fire. We read, for instance, in the book of Deuteronomy, 'A fire is kindled in my wrath and shall burn even to the lowest hell.' And in the book of Job, 'A fire that is not kindled shall devour him,' revealing that this fire of hell needs not to be nourished, but once enkindled by God, burns eternally. There are a number of passages in the book of Isaiah referring to this fire of hell. Which of you can dwell with devouring fire? Which of you shall dwell with everlasting burnings? Their worms shall not die, and their fire shall not be quenched, and they shall be a loathsome sight to all flesh. He will give fire and worms into their flesh, that they may burn and may feel forever." Judith 16:21. Hell is a fire of a particular type, a fire prepared expressly to avenge the injuries which sin has done to God by carnal pleasures. For as the book of Ecclesiasticus remarks, "The vengeance on the flesh of the ungodly is fire and worms," end quote.
But as I'm falling, and I enter this portal, and I feel the heat, I'm hearing the yells, it's like it's just overwhelming. And at this time, by the time I got to the bottom, I just knew I was in hell, and I knew I was going to hell. But once I passed the portal, all I remember is when I hit the bottom, I didn't feel anything when I first hit. So I'm trying to think, you know, I was asking, was it the Lord that softened the blow when I first hit? But when I fell and I raised my eyes, it felt like I had no strength. I felt like I hadn't eaten for like months. I couldn't breathe. It was horrible. Just a feeling of just nothing. And then, but the only thing that kept coming to my mind was, and I know the Lord did this purposely, was thinking that everything that I took for granted, movement, a drink of water, you know, just to have the ability to move my arms just freely, the ability to breathe, all the things that we take for granted, it was going through my mind. I knew it came from God. I knew I took it for granted.
Acts 17:24-25. "The God who made the world and everything in it, he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything."
And there, first thing is I look over. See, it was dark, but I'm trying to, you know, wonder if the Lord was making me be able to see. But the flames itself were emitting so high from these pews, like these vents from the rocks.
His statement that flames burst high in hell corresponds to various visions of hell. For instance, Dritheum, who saw hell, stated, quote, "As those same billows of fire without pause at one time flew up, and at another time fell back into the bottom of the abyss, I saw that the summits of all the flames as they ascended were full of the spirits of men, like sparks flying upward with the smoke. They were sometimes thrown up high, and again when the vapors of the fire fell, they dropped down into the depths below," end quote. The Fatima children were shown a vision of hell by the Blessed Virgin Mary on July 13, 1917, which was followed up by the famous Miracle of Fatima on October 13, 1917. In their vision of hell, they saw, quote, "flames that issued from within themselves, together with great clouds of smoke, now falling back on every side, like sparks in huge fires," end quote. Dominic also describes hell as being a place on earth, but in a different dimension.
And that's another thing, too, I want to add. I don't want to move too fast, but one thing I do want to add. For some reason, I knew I was still here on Earth. I still knew I wasn't in outer space somewhere. I wasn't under space. I was in a different dimension, but I was still on Earth. I knew that. I knew it's here on Earth. So the Lord is right. Hell is a place on Earth. The scriptures are right. It is here on Earth. It's just a different dimension.
This also corresponds to the vision of the Fatima children, who saw hell when rays of light seemed to penetrate the Earth. Quote, "The rays of light seemed to penetrate the Earth, and we saw as it were a sea of fire. Plunged in this fire were demons and souls in human form, like transparent burning embers, all blackened or burnished bronze, floating about in the conflagration," end quote. St. Alphonsus stated, "God has established a definite place for the demons and the reprobate, as is evident from several texts of sacred scripture." St. Jerome deduces this specifically from a passage in the Book of Numbers. Here is described the fate of Dathan and Abiram, who were precipitated into hell, falling into a chasm which opened under their very feet. At the same time, a great flame burst from the earth and killed 250 men who were accomplices in their sin. Moreover, in many passages of sacred scripture, the word descend is used in reference to hell, indicating that hell is situated in the bowels of the earth, end quote.
So as I'm looking around and I'm just already, what I see when the flames, they come up and then you can see the illumination from the flames, you can see. And the first thing I noticed were these demons, things, they're the most grotesque, smelliest, Hollywood can't even get close to how these things look. They're so deformed. They had legs and twisted arms, but they had a reptilian look, a reptile look to them. And their eyes were glowing yellow. Some of them eyes were red. Some of them were like 13 feet tall. Some of them were this big. They're everywhere. And it's just bugs, there's spiders, there's just everything. But what really caught my attention was these pits everywhere. And this one demon glanced at me and he started laughing. But down in the pits were just people.
His descriptions of the horrible, grotesque, and deformed appearance of the demons in hell corresponds remarkably to other visions. For example, the Fatima vision states, quote, "The demons could be distinguished by their terrifying and repellent likeness to frightful and unknown animals," end quote. St. John Bosco, who died in 1888, had a famous vision of hell. He described seeing a hideous monster there, quote, "I kept tugging, and after a long while, a huge, hideous monster emerged, clutching a rope to which all those traps were tied together," end quote. Also, the vision of Tundale was a popular writing in the Middle Ages. It tells the story of an Irish knight who fell unconscious for 3 days, during which time an angel guided his soul through heaven and hell, and he experienced torments of the damned. Tundale also described the demons as looking like frightful and unknown creatures. Quote, "Their bodies were like dragons, their tails were like scorpions. Their teeth were sharp, they had wings long and broad. They had tusks great and strong," end quote.
But down in the pits were just people, okay? Yeah, I mean, just people. But then I thought it was just one pit. As you really look around and the flames illuminate all of the space around, there's, I would say, hundreds of thousands of pits. And then within each pit, are thousands of people. Okay, and then around the pits, you have nothing but these grotesque demon reptilian or reptile-like things, making sure they don't crawl out. It was horrible. You have people who look like bone. I would say they look like bones. Some of them were bones, but actually flesh hanging off, which is incomprehensible to some people to even imagine how, you know, but the things that I saw and the tortures that I saw is that you regenerate. So just say if your arm falls off, it'll grow right back so you can get tortured again. It's a place of pure torture, like torture. Hell is no relief. There's nothing.
Isaiah 66:24. "Their worm will not die, and their fire will not be extinguished."
As I'm looking in this one demon, he was about 8 feet tall. He looked at me and laughed. And then all I remember was these thousands of maggots, worms, and they're like thick. They're thick. They look, they're thick as soda cans. Okay, they're not like regular maggots here in this dimension. They are thick and they're big, and they started to chew at my feet. And then once it was a few of them, when I looked down, there was hundreds of them. They start to make a mound around me, up to my knees.
St. John Bosco, who had a vision of hell, described something similar. Quote, "I drew closer to them and noticed that they were all covered with worms and vermin, which gnawed at their vitals, hearts, eyes, hands, legs, and entire bodies, so ferociously as to defy description," end quote.
But that was the least of my worries, because I felt getting a hand picked me up from the back of my head, and it flung me, it flew. Now, as I flew, okay, now remember, you have no energy, there's no Nothing. Even just when I laid down, I couldn't get back up. But now I'm realizing, you know, in hindsight, that the Lord was with me, because a lot of these demons, they wanted to attack me. They wanted to rip me apart. And I could just feel the hatred that they have for mankind, the hatred that they have for us. It is beyond anything. It is beyond, and you can feel it's ancient, and you can feel it is powerful. It is power in their hate. It is so powerful. Yeah. All right, 1 second. Okay.
Revelation chapter 12 speaks of the ancient war between St. Michael and the fallen angels, which resulted in those fallen angels, that is the demons, being cast out of heaven. In John 8:44, the Lord Jesus Christ refers to Satan as a murderer from the beginning. Satan was an ancient murderer. 1 John 3:15 connects hatred with murder. Thus, the demons have an ancient hatred for God and mankind.
The hatred that they have for mankind, the hatred that they have for us, it is beyond anything. It is beyond, and you can feel it's ancient, and you can feel it is powerful. It is power in their hate.
I always try to describe people that the hate that these demonic things, that these demonic beings have for us, it is so powerful. Just the hate alone, if that's how I know there's something holding it back. Even here on earth, when they harass us and terrorize us, there's got to be some kind of shield holding back that hatred, because just the vibration from the hate alone is so powerful. It is ancient, it's powerful, it is dark, it is gripping. They hate us. But then all of a sudden I saw like pits, and the only way I can see is because the illumination of these pits were flaming. It was like just bursting like little furnaces. And then that's how I can see. But then what terrified me the most, okay, is the fact that as I'm laying there, the pits, when they were illuminating the space that I was in, I looked, you saw, I mean, thousands, as far as your eye can see, of these pits. And there were people in these pits, okay? Some of them were skeletal, some of them had flesh hanging off of them, and they were like in pools of lava. But when I really looked, there were these demons, creatures, reptile-looking things. Some of them were huge. Some of them, I would just guesstimate, I'm going to say 13 feet tall, 12 feet tall. Some of them were small. Some of them were like 3 feet tall. They were just so grotesque, and there were so many of them standing around the pits while people were trying to crawl out the pits. They were throwing them back in. They had like these rusty, everything looks ancient there too, as far as the tools they were using. I'm going to get describe that soon enough. But they would try to get out, and they were kicking them in, and they were laughing and just throwing these people back in these pits. I mean, as far as your eye can see, I mean, and there's people screaming and yelling and in horror, like it is indescribable.
And that's when I think the Lord showed me it was the whole hell of this section, because hell has sections. I'm going to explain that soon. It has many sections. It was illuminated for me where I can just see everything. And when I tell you the tortures, wow, I mean, it is beyond the stretch of your imagination.
His statement that hell has sections corresponds to St. John Bosco's vision, in which he saw, quote, instantly 1,000 inner portals opened with a deafening clamor, end quote.
One thing that I noticed when you're in hell and when you're internally in your spirit body, you can look at a person inside hell and you know why they're there. You instantaneously know, you know why that person is there. I've seen people there for unforgiveness. I've seen people there who thought they would be the best in the church, saying, why did you do this to me? I've seen pastors there. I've seen even some preteens in hell. I've seen a lot of people who think they're doing the right thing, but they're no. Like, for example, the first lady who I saw getting tortured individually, not the people in the pits, there were two demons, and they were laughing, these reptile things, and they had her mouth, and they stretched her mouth so far back, like to rip her jaw open, and they were pouring lava down her throat and sticking her throat with spears and just like these old ancient looking rusty daggers, and they were getting a kick, and it was horrible. But then the fact is, she turned the bone, she was breaking up, and then she would rejuvenate, and they would do it all over again and over again and over. And they were taking turns, they were inviting other demonic spirits, they were laughing, they were having fun torturing this lady. And when I looked, and I really knew, I this has to be the Lord, I already knew why she was there. She was there because not only was she a gossiper, She was gossiping about people. She got many people life turned because of her tongue, and she was an alcoholic.
Concerning gossips and slanderers, Exodus 23:1 states, "You shall not spread a false report. You shall not join hands with a wicked man to be a malicious witness." James 1:26, "If anyone considers himself religious and yet does not bridle his tongue, he deceives his heart, and his religion is worthless." Concerning drunkards and others who die in the state of mortal sin, 1 Corinthians 6 says, quote, "Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will enter the kingdom of God." End quote. This is divine revelation. Dominic also describes seeing the fornicators and those who look at pornography, those who masturbate, commit adultery, and other sexual sins flowing through the lake of fire in hell.
And I'm starting to, there was a theme in hell I started to notice, because people commit a lot of sins on a wide spectrum. But the one that sticks out the most is the one that's going to rectify, that you're going to get inside hell. So let's say, you know, a person who is promiscuous, and that's another one I'm going to keep it not explicit, but I saw a young lady in hell. There were demons literally taking turns having sex with this one. And when I say it's not regular sexual intercourse, it was beyond mine. I mean, I can't say too much to describe, but all I can say is that she was very promiscuous when she was here on this earth, and they were torturing her in ways that you can't even imagine.
But then the river of lava started to speed up, and it's like, and it started coming so fast, and more, you just see more and more, and you just hear the voices, and they start going past. Instantly, I knew what these people. These people were the ones after they got tortured. Fornicators. And I thought, I saw the torture of the promiscuous women and stuff getting out. These is all fornicators. These is the whole river. It was a whole lava river flowing through hell with these people who just fornicate, people who cheated on their spouses, people who debate, people who watch porn, right? People who prey on little. Okay, it was like they paraded them, and it flows through hell. It's like a parade of these misfits that just flow through hell.
The biggest sins that you have, because like I said, everybody sins on different spectrums and think it's nothing. It does. No, everything counts. Everything counts. And it's not God, our Father, up there taking a list of you. It also says in the Bible that the flesh will testify against itself. So people, that is real. Your flesh testifies against you. Your flesh, your desires. That's why he always tells us to get away from pleasing our own flesh, because we're going to put ourselves there. The Lord cries, the Lord's heart aches for us, every one of us that go to hell. He does not want that. He does not want that for us at all. It really tears him apart to see us in that predicament. But it's back to the tortures, unfortunately. That was only one section. And I thought, that's mind blowing. That was only one section with the pits. So I thought that, no. And I think the Lord was with me. I don't know if anybody ever had a dream before where you couldn't see the person's face, but you know somebody was there standing with you. I know the Lord was with me, but I never saw him. But I knew he was the one directing me and protecting me, because these things wanted to eat me and tear me apart. But the second thing I remember is another section of hell. And that's another thing. When you move in hell, there's no really walking around. When he's showing you, it's like you instantaneous. It's like teleportation. When I teleported to this other part of hell, okay, I saw these cells. Okay. And I grew up in skyscrapers, uptown Chicago. Grew up on the 16th floor. And these things were taller than that. These things had to be 50 stories tall, and it was a row of them, all the way as your eyes can see, looking up. And they open old bar cells, and there are people in them. There are people in them. Some of them look like skeletons. Some of them were just burned, like to a crisp, and they're cursing God, and they were just very angry to be there. There was no repentance. There was no asking for another chance. Those are the ones who were just very angry at our Lord. They were very angry. Some of them even started looking like almost a reptilian look because of the hatred coming out of them.
On the people cursing God and the saints, St. John Bosco, when he saw hell, quote, "heard screams and sobs, blasphemies and imprecations against the saints. It was a tumult of voices and cries, shrill and confused," end quote.
And also I noticed some of them been there for thousands of years. See, that's the thing. People don't understand. Time doesn't exist in eternity. It doesn't. The clock stops. And I realized that. I saw people there who were there 2,000 years, 4,000, and just, you just know the ancient vastness of it. I saw all different languages. It doesn't discriminate. The devil doesn't discriminate at all. The whole end point is to get you there. That's it. When I saw those cells, that's when things started to awaken to me. I saw mostly those who were in their cells were people who dabbled in witchcraft, those who dabbled in Santeria, those who dabbled in all kind of tarot cards, those who wanted to know the future in astrology. I just know, like I told you, once you go there, you know. You can just look at a person and you know while they're there. And mostly I saw there was a thing to those people in those cells, and those are the people who worship other gods or the doctrines of demons, what they call also in the scriptures. And what's so terrifying about that is that here, because I have my brush with Santeria, unfortunately growing up, and they promise you everything materialistically. But what they don't tell you is once you worship these, you know, these demons, now that I know they are, I didn't know that before. They make it seem like they're positive, they're good, they're here to help mankind. The nine principalities, and they give you all the wealth you want. You do these rituals and stuff, but you don't realize you owe them. And what you owe them is beyond this earth. You're gonna have a spot. They have a spot waiting for you. It reminds me of people who say, well, I didn't know the law. I didn't know. But if you go to court, you will still go to jail. Ignorance is not a way out of it, you all. So I'm just telling you, watch what you do. Watch what you confer, because psychics and all of these mediums and things of that nature, of course they're gonna tell you things that are right on purpose, because they call it familiar spirits, which I saw them ascending and descending from hell. But that's, I will get to that too. But just be careful, you all, playing with witchcraft, any astrology, anything of that nature, because they have a place just in hell for you. And also the Lord told me that this place grows every day. Actually, it's growing by the second. It's like the hell is alive. It is a place that it is a dimension that is alive. You can even feel it. The ground of hell, it moves in waves. It's like a wave. You can feel it under your feet. It's as if, you know, it's like kind of like breathing, but I wouldn't consider it breathing. But it just had a component the same way the darkness has. It was alive.
St. Teresa of Avila, who died in 1582, had a brief vision of hell. She said, quote, "The soil was foul mud full of filthy reptiles. In the distance on the wall, there was a cavity carved out like a niche, and in it I felt tightly confined. And that which I then suffered exceeds every human imagination, nor does it seem possible to give even an idea of it, because they are things which are indescribable," end quote.
These, like, it was rocks coming out of the pit, and they were so hot, they were turning white. They like piping hot, orange, white, and they start plopping out.
His description of the white-hot rocks coming out of the pit corresponds to the vision of St. John Bosco. Quote, "The entire cave, walls, ceiling, floor, iron, stones, wood, and coal, everything was a glowing white at temperatures of thousands of degrees. Yet the fire did not incinerate, did not consume. I simply can't find words to describe the cavern's horror," end quote.
But as I fall and I see this portal, it looked like old cave, like I'm entering an old cave system.
Dominic describes how the demons torture the damned souls, which also corresponds to the visions of Drythium and St. John Bosco. The vision of Drythium states, quote, "The evil spirits that dragged them went down into the midst of the burning pit. As they went down deeper, I could no longer distinguish between the lamentation of the men and the laughing of the devils, yet I still had a confused sound in my ears. In the meantime, some of the dark spirits ascended from that flaming abyss. Running forward, they assaulted me on all sides. With their flaming eyes and the disgusting fire that they breathed forth from their mouths and nostrils, they tried to choke me. Then they threatened to lay hold on me with fiery tongues, which they had in their hands," end quote. Dominic describes the constant and horrifying noise of hell.
But just to hear the roar, and it was kicking up these hot coals and rocks, and the demons would come, and they would drag the people with these hot coals and rocks, and they were struggling in their face. And it was just, oh, you can hear the muffle, and it was just, oh, they would just melt their whole face off. Like, the torture there feeds these demons. So the more grotesque they can torture you, the more power that they get. They get food off of it. They get high off torturing. They get high off your misery and pain there. That is their food. So they get very creative in torturing you, and it is no negotiation. There, I hear a lot of, please stop. I hear a lot of, you know, regret. I hear a lot of the noise is never stopped, nonstop, and it just screams and screams and screams.
This corresponds to the vision of Tundale, which states, quote, "How hideous was the noise of hell."
But when they speak to each other and they're laughing, you can clearly hear and understand what they're saying. okay? And a lot of them were laughing and just calling us stupid. They were laughing and calling us stupid, naive, ignorant, basic. Like, they were the name that they call us, but it was in their language, but you can still understand it. But when they speak, it hurts you. It feels, you can feel the pain. That's why I do not like the curse. That's why it's called a curse word. See, all of that stuff comes from hell, and people need to realize this. We have been born into a spiritual war, and a lot of things that we think that are small are really are huge, okay? A lot of these things come from hell. Just like I noticed the way some of these things were walking, okay? They're very deformed. Some of these demons are so grotesque. Hollywood can't do them justice. Hollywood can't replicate the way some of these things look, the way they feel, smell, talk, sound. And some of them walk, their legs are so deformed, like some of them look like animal hybrid type things, but their legs are twisted sideways. Some of them don't have regular legs. Some of their legs are still backwards with the forward abdomen, but their legs, like the bottom of the buttocks is in front of them, right? So when they walk, it looks very creepy. It looks weird, you know? And I noticed some of these dances that these people do, these modern dances that they do these days, that's how they walk. It's hard to explain. I noticed, that's why I said, this has to come from hell. When I catch a glimpse of a certain video or look at certain people, the way they move and dance, that's the same way some of these demonic things walk and glide around. It is creepy. It is beyond explanation.
His statement that the demons laugh as they torture damned souls corresponds to the vision of Dritheum. Quote, I heard behind me the sound of a mighty and miserable lamentation, and at the same time noisy laughter, like the tumult of a rude multitude insulting captured enemies. When that noise growing plainer came close to me, I saw a crowd of evil spirits dragging five souls of men, wailing and shrieking, into the midst of the darkness, while they themselves exulted and laughed. End quote. He also stated, as we cited, as they went down deeper, I could no longer distinguish between the lamentation of the men and the laughing of the devils. He describes the river or lake of fire in hell, which of course is also mentioned in scripture.
But it's lava and it flows all through. And from what I know now, it flows, it's like a river in hell. It's a river in hell that flows all through and it goes through. And there are boatloads of people with the current, riding this current in hell.
He describes the profound regret in hell.
Talking, screaming, full of regret. That's the one thing I want to let people know. Take care of everything you have to take care of now, because in hell, the most thing I was hearing was regret. That some people were asking for a minute to be back on earth, 5 minutes. Can I, you know, just give me one more chance. I want to do it right this time, please. That's all you hear. That's all you hear is regret. That's it. And the regret and the pain is so bad just to hear the regret. It hurts.
Wisdom chapter 5, quote, therefore we have erred from the way of truth, and the light of justice did not shine unto us. And the Son of Understanding has not risen upon us. We wearied ourselves in the way of iniquity and destruction, and have walked through hard ways. But the way of the Lord we have not known. What has pride profited us? Or what advantage has the boasting of riches brought us? All those things are passed away like a shadow, and like a fleeting rumor. Such things as these the sinners said in hell. We believe that Dominic, who by his own admission lived a bad life, was given a special grace to see hell, so that he and others could benefit from it. However, the mistake that some people make is then to think that because they received a special grace to recognize some truth, or to change in a certain way, that they are suddenly where they need to be, or that they understand everything about Christianity. No, just because he was given this grace to see what hell is like, does not mean that he understands everything about Christianity or about hell. Rather, he needs to, in humility, seek out the full truth, which is found in true traditional Catholicism, as our material explains. That's what's necessary for salvation. People should see our website, VaticanCatholic.com, and our videos for information about what people need to know and do to be saved. We also recommend that people, if they can, pray 15 decades of the Rosary each day, and the Hail Mary frequently. Job 10, quote, before I go and return no more to a land that is dark and covered with the mist of death, a land of misery and darkness, where the shadow of death and no order but everlasting horror dwelleth.
But once you pass those gates, it's done. The sentence is done.